I've made videos on the two biggest and most expanded wizarding schools in the Harry Potter series, Hogwarts and the American wizarding school, Ilvermorny, which I'll link both in the description. But many of you have been asking me to talk about the other wizarding schools around the world. So in this video, I'm going to do just that and explain everything Rowling has released on the Japanese, French, Brazilian, Bulgarian, and African schools. Now you might be thinking, why are there so little schools? And Rowling actually answered that. This is because the wizarding populations in most countries choose the option of homeschooling. This is because sometimes the magical community in a given country is too small or too far away, and they find that correspondence courses are a more cost-effective means of educating the young.
Brilliant.
There are 11 long-established and prestigious wizarding schools worldwide, all of which are registered with the International Confederation of Wizards. There have been some smaller and less well-regulated institutions that have come and gone, which are difficult to keep track of because they're rarely registered with the appropriate ministry. Considering this, these schools might not be very good. If wizards or witches wanted to know if there were any approved magical schools in their region, they simply had to send an owl to the International Confederation of Wizards Educational Office, and they would let them know. The location of all these schools is a closely guarded secret because the schools feared Muggle persecution. All of these institutions have been negatively affected by the wizarding wars and have gotten hostile attention from both the foreign and domestic magical communities. Most of them also had some ministry interference, something we saw happen at Hogwarts. As a result of this, most magical schools tend to be located in mountainous areas, making it difficult for Muggles to access and easier to defend against dark wizards. The first school we're going to look at is that of the ancient Japanese called Mahutokoro. It has the smallest student body of all 11 schools, and they start taking students at the early age of 7, although they're not allowed to live there or stay the night until they're 11. The day students under the age of 11 are flown back and forth to their homes every day on the backs of a flock of giant storm pretels. The ornate and exquisite palace of Mahutokoro stands on the topmost point of an uninhabited, or so Muggles think, volcanic island of Manami Iwo Jima. Students are presented with enchanted robes when they arrive, which grow in size as the children themselves do. The robes gradually change color as the learning of their wearer increases. It begins with a faint pink color, and if top grades are achieved in every magical subject, it becomes gold. If the robes turn white, this is an indication that the student has betrayed the Japanese wizard's code and took part in illegal practices, or as they say in Europe, dark magic. It also turns white if they break the International Statute of Secrecy. The robe turning white is a terrible disgrace which results in an instant expulsion from the school and trial at the Japanese Ministry of Magic. The school's great reputation is not only because of its impressive academic prowess, but also on its outstanding reputation for Quidditch. Legend says that it was introduced to Japan centuries ago by a band of foolhardy Hogwarts students who were blown off course during an attempt to travel around the entire earth on broomsticks. They were rescued by the Mahutokoro wizarding staff, who had been observing the movements of the planets. The Hogwarts students remained guests long enough to teach their Japanese counterparts the rules of Quidditch, a move that they lived to regret as the Japanese surpassed them in skill. Every member of the Japanese Quidditch team and the current Champions League winners, the Toyohashi Tengu, attribute their success to the rigid training they were given at Mahutokoro, where they practiced in terrible stormy conditions. They were taught not only how to fly in the bad weather, but to dodge both bludgers and planes from the Muggle airbase on a neighboring island. The next school we'll look at is Beauxbatons, the French school. We of course saw them in the Goblet of Fire, as they were part of the Triwizard Tournament, but we never got much detail on their school. It's situated somewhere in the Pyrenees Mountains. Visitors speak of the breathtaking beauty of the chateau, surrounded by formal gardens and lawns. All of this was created out of the mountainous landscape using magic. The academy has mostly French students, though Spanish, Portuguese, Dutch, Luxembourgians, and Belgians also attend in large numbers. Because of this, they have many more students than Hogwarts. Another thing I feel is worth mentioning is that while the films made it look like it was an all-girls school, in the books, it's actually co-ed, something that many people aren't aware of. It's said that the stunning castle and grounds of this prestigious school were part funded by the Flamels, Nicholas and Perronel Flamel. Nicholas Flamel was of course the wizard responsible for the Philosopher's Stone, and he just made his film debut in the Fantastic Beasts series and Crimes of Grindelwald.
Nicolas Flamel.
The Flamels met the founder of the school, Beauxbatons, in their youth. There's a magnificent fountain in the middle of the school's park, believed to have healing and beautifying properties, and Beaubaton named this after the Flamels. Beaubaton School has always enjoyed a friendly relationship with Hogwarts, though there has been a healthy rivalry in international competitions such as the Triwizard Tournament, in which Beaubaton has 62 wins and Hogwarts has 63. The next school is the Brazilian School for Magic, called Castelo Bruxo. The school takes students from all over South America. The school is hidden deep within the rainforest. The fabulous castle appears to be a ruin for any muggle that sees it, a trick shared by Hogwarts, although the opinion is divided on who got the idea first. The school is a giant, squarish building made of golden rock, often compared to a temple. Both the building and the grounds are protected by the Queporta, which are small spirit beings who are very mischievous and tricky. They emerge at night to watch over the students and the creatures who live in the forest. The school's former headmistress, Benedita Dorado, was once on an exchange visit to Hogwarts. The Hogwarts headmaster at the time was Armando Dippet, and he complained to Dorado about Peeves the Poltergeist. Dorado rolled her eyes and replied by offering to send some Queporta to show him what trouble really was. Dippet, of course, did not take on the offer. Castelo Bruxo students wear bright green robes and are especially advanced in both herbology and magizoology. The school offers very popular foreign exchange programs for the European students who wish to study the magical flora and fauna of South America. The next school is Durmstrang from Bulgaria. This was another school introduced to us in the Goblet of Fire for the Triwizard Tournament, but again, we only saw a few of its students and never got to know anything about the school itself. We did, however, learn in the Deathly Hallows that Gellert Grindelwald went there and was expelled. Although believed to be situated in the far north of Europe, Durmstrang is one of the most secretive schools about its whereabouts, so nobody that isn't part of it can be quite certain where it is exactly. Visitors are forced to undergo memory charms that erase their knowledge of how they got there. However, they do let them remember the sprawling grounds with many stunning views. This includes a great, dark, and mysterious ship that rests on a mountain lake behind the school. Many students dive in here during the summertime. Student-wise, the school is much larger than Hogwarts. Durmstrang once had the darkest reputation of the 11 wizarding schools, though this was never entirely merited. It's true that Durmstrang, which has produced many truly great wizards and witches, has twice in history fallen under the leadership of wizards that don't have the best reputation or beliefs on good values. One of these men was Harfang Munzer, who took over the school shortly after the mysterious death of its founder, the great Bulgarian witch, Nerdia Volchanova. Munzer established Durmstrang's reputation for dueling and all forms of martial magic, which remains a big part of the curriculum today. The second dark period in Durmstrang's history was actually during the period in which the 7 Harry Potter books took place. This was when Igor Karkaroff was their headmaster. He was an ex-Death Eater who ratted out his former allies to ensure his freedom. When Voldemort returned, however, he fled and was eventually killed. But being an unprincipled and egotistical man, he left behind encouraging a culture of fear and intimidation among his students. Many parents withdrew their children from Durmstrang while he was in charge. After producing such evil wizards as Gellert Grindelwald and being under the control of Munzer and Karkaroff, the school in recent years has undergone great change, most would agree for the better. Proof of this is how it has produced such international icons such as professional Quidditch star Victor Krum. The last school that we're going to focus on is the African School. Although Africa has had a number of smaller wizarding schools, there is only one that has stood the test of time dating back over 1,000 years. It's called Ouagadou, and it has achieved an enviable international reputation. It's the largest of all wizarding schools, welcoming students from all over the enormous continent. The only address ever given for its location is Mountains of the Moon. Visitors speak of the stunning complex carved out of the mountainside. On the mountain, the school is shrouded in mist, so that it sometimes appears to simply be floating in midair. Much of today's magic, and some might even say all magic, originated in Africa, and Ouagadou graduates are especially well versed in astronomy, alchemy, and self-transfiguration. Students receive notice that they have gained entrance to Ouagadou from dream messengers sent by the headmaster and headmistress at the time. The dream messenger will appear to the children as they sleep, and they will leave a token, most of the time an inscribed stone, which is found in the child's hand when they wake up. The wand is a European invention, and while African witches and wizards have adopted it as a useful tool in the last century, many of their spells are cast simply by pointing a finger or through hand gestures. This gives Ouagadou students a sturdy line of defense when accused of breaking the international statute of secrecy, being able to say things like, "I was only waving, I never meant for his chin to fall off." Yes, that's an actual example made by Rowling. At a recent international symposium of Animagi, the Wagadu team attracted a lot of press when their exhibition of synchronized Animagus transforming caused a near riot. It's incredibly difficult to become an Animagus, and at the time that the Prisoner of Azkaban took place, there were only a few registered Animagi, including Professor McGonagall. Many older and more experienced witches and wizards at the symposium felt threatened by 14-year-olds who could turn into elephants and cheetahs at will. Because of this, they lodged a formal complaint to the International Confederation of Wizards. So far, Hogwarts, Ilvermorny, Beauxbatons, Castellabruccio, Durmstrang, Mohutokoro, and Wagadu are only 7 out of the 11 schools that we know of so far. Hopefully, Rowling will expand on the other 4 unknown schools soon, and when she does, I'll be sure to make a video about them.
Thank you so much for watching, guys. You can follow me on social media. Links for that will be down below. If you like this video, make sure you press that subscribe button to help grow the channel. I want to give a huge shout out to all my patrons listed below. If you want to be featured on the next video, plus get a bunch of other rewards, check out my Patreon. Again, thank you so much for watching, and look out for more great videos on the way.